Jesus cried out with a loud voice, saying, Eli! Eli! Lama sabachthani? That is, my God, my God. Why have you forsaken me? Anybody here been let down? Anybody ever been disappointed?
All right.
Anybody ever been told, go ahead, I got you back? Only to find out that when you do step out and you look around and you can't find anyone, even if you're looking with a telescope.
Well.
But in this word, it's a good thing to know that we serve a God who would never desert or abandon us.
Thank you, Jesus.
In this word, there is a depth of feeling in this cry of Jesus from the heart. Wasn't just an ordinary cry, but it was a cry that came, you know, that good cry. That cry that comes from the very bone and marrow and center of our being. It was a cry made with an intensity matched only by the darkness which had draped itself over that terrible spectacle. It's surely symbolic that the sun refused to shine on such a scene as the crucifixion of our beloved Savior. The darkness, we're told, lasted 3 long hours. And it was an outward sign of the darkness that has now draped the very soul of Jesus Christ. Here, Jesus is now bearing all of the sins of the world, now being placed upon his shoulders. Where we find 2 Corinthians 5 and 21 being played out, he who knew no sin was made to be sin for us, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. Not more than 24 hours ago, if that long, Jesus is heard telling his disciples that in his hour of trial, they would all desert him. But he went on to say, yet I am not alone, for my Father is with me. But here in this fourth utterance, at the height of his passion, here at the very moment of making atonement for our sins, we find that it is now necessary that even his own Father would have to step aside. When we look at it, just like in Old Testament time, when the sins of the community was placed upon the scapegoat had to be banished out into the wilderness. So we see Jesus here bearing the sins of the world all by himself. God forsaken. You see, we have to understand that Jesus is now in a place of the likes of which he never been throughout his ministry. But there was never a time that Jesus experienced being separated from his Father. And here we are witnessing he who was made sin for us, feeling the punishment that's experienced by the sinner. And that punishment is being separated from our Creator. And that's why this prayer ought to be our daily utterance. My God, don't let me be separated from you. Now how Jesus felt as his loud cry broke the silence of that moment of destiny, we cannot fully know. But what we do know is that never before did Jesus have to stand alone, forsaken by God, his Father. Yet, although he was forsaken, he never ceased to be his Father's well-beloved son. For he never lost sight of the fact that he was only carrying out the will of his Father by becoming our atonement for sin. I don't know about you, but I'm so glad about it. This word from the cross points us to the cost of the atonement made. And when I read that, I couldn't help but say in the very depths of my being, thank God, in the words of a songwriter, that the blood still works. In this word, we see not only the depths of evil, but we also see the depths of God's grace, mercy, and love towards us. For it is God's desire to see us set free from the penalty of sin. And so it's good to see that when God looked out upon the world and saw us in the condition we were in, it's good to know that the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost called an official boy me. The Father, Son, and Holy Ghost called a church conference. The Father, Son, and Holy Ghost called an annual conference. The Father, Son, and Holy Ghost called a general conference. And they collaborated together and showed themselves unto the devil, the world, and the flesh to let them know that they have no power over God's people.
All right.
Because of God's mercy towards us, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit were greatly affected by our sin. They began to collaborate and come together and make their way into the earth that we might be set free from the penalty of sin. For when the Son of God took on your sins, my sins, the sins of the whole world in order to judge it, condemn it, and have its power broken in him and upon him, then the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit endured the disruption of their triune life of holy union and communion just to save a wretch like you and like me. Whenever I read this, I can't help but be so glad about it, that he thought of me on this day and time while Jesus was hanging upon the cross. But when we look at it, the cost of God's mercy towards us was Jesus' experience of being utterly abandoned by God. But God himself in Christ, by the power of the Spirit, willingly suffered so that we might not be forsaken by God, but rather enter into an eternal union and communion with our Lord and Savior. And so we learned from this fourth word from the cross that during our times of suffering, God is near us, even when it seems like he's a million miles away. For we have the reassurance that because he did not abandon Jesus on the cross, if we are faithful, he will never abandon us either. We finally learned from this world that during our times of suffering, we, like Jesus, must remain faithful unto God.
Yes.
Even if we feel isolated by him. For hear him say unto us, if we are faithful even unto death, the day will come when he will give us a crown of righteousness. Although Jesus felt isolated while on the cross, he didn't give up on his faith. He trusted God and remained faithful. And if we do this, God will, in due season, reward us for our faithfulness. That's how I believe the hymn writer can aptly say, be not dismayed, whatever be time, God will take care of you. Beneath his wing of love abide, God will take care of you. If 19, the Lord gave his disciples what we know as the Great Commission. It was a call to serve him. And one can imagine the tension in the hearts of the disciples who are now being asked to carry on the work of the Lord. Now, get this, these were the very disciples who deserted him when he needed them most. But however, with this command, the Lord also gave a great promise to his disciples, where he says in Matthew 28 and 20, "And surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age." In other words, the Lord was simply saying that he would never leave them, nor would he abandon them. And we can give God praise on this Good Friday that we serve a God who never has and never will desert or abandon us. And today, we too can proclaim like Jesus did, my God, why have you forsaken me? But we know he has not forsaken us. It is just the sin that is upon us. And our God is so holy that he cannot look upon sin. So he did not forsake him. For Jesus knew that in due season, that season that's controlled by God, that all things would be worked for his good. Because he loved and trusted God and was called according to his purpose. In your struggle, just remember, God has not forgotten or abandoned you. Trials are not signs of the end. As I once heard someone say, trials are only representative of the fact that there are blessings with work clothes on. God bless you.